بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد أيها الإخوة السامعون بارك الله فيكم في هذه الدقائق نتذكر وإياكم عن أمر عظيم وعن أمر جليل ألا وهو ما بعث الله عز وجل به نبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم من الخير العظيم والنفع العميم قال الله عز وجل هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره المشركون
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم The noble Shaykh Abu Mu'ad Hussein al-Hatibi Hafidhahullah, one of the well-known Mashayikh of Yemen for his hard work and efforts and his art of conveyance of the beautiful khutbas in the communities of the, within their Yemeni communities. A man who has a markiz, who has produced students of women and children. Women, children and adults found in the center in Aden. This noble sheikh, he began, he says, with the khutbat al-hajjah, which is well known to many of us. He says, fellow brothers, as-sami'un, all those listening, in these short moments, we're going to revise and ponder over something that is great and immense, of what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent with, of the greatest of goodness. And he recited the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has dispatched his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with beneficial knowledge and righteous good deeds. So he can make it outward the most apparent of all, over all religions and beliefs. تفضل يا شيخ.
والله عز وجل في هذه الآية بين أنه أرسل نبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم بالهدى وهو العلم النافع ودين الحق وهو العمل الصالح فدعا نبينا صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى الله تبارك وتعالى فأحيا الله عز وجل به قلوبا كانت ميتة وفتح الله عز وجل به آذانا كانت لا تسمع الحق ولا تقبل عليه وأحيا الله عز وجل به مجتمعا كان واقعا في أوحال الشرك والخرافة والرذيلة والجرائم والمنكرات والسيئات إلى أخرجه الله عز وجل بهذا النبي الكريم إلى نور الهداية والطاعة وانشراح الصدور وطمأنينة القلوب وسعادة النفوس فحقق خير عظيم واستجاب له الأعداد الهائلة وأقبل الله عز وجل بقلوب العباد عليه وجعل سبحانه وتعالى محبته في البشر في قلوبهم بل وفي الحيوانات بل وفي الجمادات
The noble Shaykh, may Allah preserve him, he says that Allah Azza wa Jal clarifies in this verse that he has sent his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with beneficial knowledge and righteous good deeds. He said al-huda is guidance which is intended here, beneficial knowledge. وَالَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ, and a religion of truth, which is righteous good deeds. He said he sent his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he, by that, through his dispatchment, hearts were open that were once locked, and ears that weren't able to react to accepting and hearing the khair of goodness and truth. He, by that, by his dispatchment, those ears were attentive to the truth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought by him life and enriched goodness to the society that he was in, the mujtama'. A society that was filled with khurafat, superstitions, munkarat, evil, shirk, polytheism. All of that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought life to that society through the dispatchment of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Brought the people to nur wal hidayah, to light and guidance, and also to inshirah, to their hearts being at a state of comfort and ease before it was once tightened. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed through him that the people accept the guidance in big numbers, whereas the people began to, yani aqbalu alayh, they began to be those who advance and accepting his call. And he, in fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the love of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hearts of his servants. In the hearts of his servants, rather in the animals, rather in the jamadat, that which has found of objects, and that which has no intellect of that sort. Tafadhal ya Shaykh.
ولهذا فإني سأتحدث في هذا الوقت عن مسألة واحدة تتعلق بالنبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم, ألا وهي حب المخلوقات لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم, وخصوصا من الحيوانات والجمادات. فقد روى الإمام أحمد من حديث جابر بن عبد الله رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: إنه ليس شيء بين السماء والأرض أو بين الأرض والسماء إلا وهو يعلم أني رسول الله إلا عاص الجن والإنس, ليس شيء بين الأرض والسماء إلا وهو يعلم أني رسول الله إلا عاص الجن والإنس. صححه العلامة الألباني في السلسلة الصحيحة. وأنت انظر إلى هذا الحديث العظيم: كل ما بين السماء والأرض وما فيهما يعلم أن محمد بن عبد الله هو رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, بما في ذلك الملائكة, بما في ذلك السماوات والأرض, بما في ذلك الحيوانات والنفوس, بما في ذلك الحيتان في البحار, بما في ذلك كل المخلوقات, وهي تعترف لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بالرسالة, وتعلم أنه رسول الله إلا من عصى من الجن والإنس وجحد وكفر. ولهذا فإن هناك من الحيوانات من استجاب لرسول الله وأذعن له وأحبه, وهي ليست مكلفة, أحبت رسول الله, ونحن أولى بمحبته وأولى باتباعه وأولى بالاقتداء به عليه الصلاة والسلام. جاء في الصحيحين عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يقرأ بأصحابه في صلاة الفجر في مكان يقال له نخلة, وقد أرسلت الشهب على الشياطين فمنعوا من استراق السمع فجعلوا يبحثون عن السبب وجعلوا يتنقلون من مكان إلى مكان. فلما وصلوا ووجدوا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يصلي بالناس قالوا: هذا هو السبب. قال الله عز وجل: وإذ صرفنا إليك نفرا من الجن يستمعون القرآن فلما حضروه قالوا: أنصتوا. فلما قضي وضلوا إلى قومهم منذرين. قالوا: يا قومنا إنا سمعنا كتابا أنزل من بعد موسى مصدقا لما بين يدي يهدي الى الحق والى طريق مستقيم. يا قومنا اجيبوا داعي الله الى اخر الايات. الجن من اول وهله تسمع الرسول الكريم عليه الصلاه والسلام يقرا القران فتهتدي قلوبها وترجع داعيه الى الله عز وجل. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يعلم بالجن انهم يستمعون اليه، ولكن اسمع ما ثبت في البخاري عن معن بن عبد الرحمن قال: سمعت ابي قال: سالت مسروقا من ادم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بالجن ليله استمعوا القران، من الذي اخبره؟ من الذي اعلمه؟ فقال: حدثني ابوك يعني عبد الله انه ادمت به شجره، اي ان ابن مسعود ادمت به شجره، اخبرت النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى اله وصحبه وسلم.
The noble Shaykh, may Allah preserve him, he went on to say, we're going to speak and address a topic that is concerning the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, concerning from the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that loved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from the animals, from even the animals. He says, it comes in Musnad Imam Ahmed and Jabir ibn Abdullah that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there is nothing between the heavens and the earth except that it knows that I'm a messenger of Allah, and except that it knows that I'm a messenger of Allah, except those who are asim from the jinn and the ins, those who disobey and refuse of the jinn and the ins. So he says, look at this, ponder over this great hadith, that everything knows, attests to that the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger, and that it contains the inhabitants of the heavens, of the malaika, the inhabitants in the earth, and that which is found therein, of wuhush, the wild animals, and even up to the degree of the hitan fil bahar, the fishes in the ocean. From the likes of these creation, they attest to the risala, that the prophethood and that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with the message from his Lord. And he said, except of from those of the creation who have disobeyed from the ins and the jinn, and those who have jahada wa kafar, those who have denied and rejected and disbelieved. He says, this is from relating to animals, that they love the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So how is it the case with us, of humans, that we should be more in a state of love for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He says it comes on Ibn Abbas in Bukhari Muslim that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was once reciting Qur'an at a place, yuqalu laha nakhla, date palms of trees found in there. And the devils were prevented, or they were targeted with shooting stars that prevented them from listening to the news of the heavens. So they went on search from one place to another to find out what is preventing them, what is this reason. So they came and they found Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reciting the Quran. So they said, this is the sabab, this is the reason, this is the cause. So there then it happened, what was mentioned in the Quran, إِذْ صَرَفْنَا إِلَيْكَ نَفَرًا مِنَ الْجِنِّ. There then we subjugated a group. And remember when we sent towards you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 3 to 10 persons of the jinn, quietly listening to the Qur'an. When they stood in the presence thereof, they said, listen in silence. When it was finished, they returned to their people as warners. They said, O our people, verily we have heard a book, meaning this Qur'an, that was sent down after Musa, confirming what came before it. It guides to the truth and to a straight path. They wanted to say, oh, our people, respond with obedience to Allah's caller and believe in Him. He will forgive you of your sins, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and will save you from a painful torment. Here, he said, look at this. Min awwali wuhla, from the first moment, their guidance covered, went within their hearts, and they became du'at, callers upon that. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at that time, he wasn't aware of the incident that they knew that he was the messenger of Allah, or they were listening. But it comes on a narration on Ma'an bin Abdul Rahman that he asks, he enters upon Masruq and he says, what has informed the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what made the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam come to know that they were listening to his recitation? So there then he says, haddathani Abuk, your father, Abdullah, informed me that during the time of him reciting at the area where the trees were, they were listening to the Qur'an and they were informed. Tafadhal ya Shaykh.
عن أنس بن مالك وابن عباس رضي الله عنهم أجمعين وجاء عن غيرهم أن النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم كان يخطب يوم الجمعة وكان يقوم إلى جانب جذع نخلة فبعد ذلك جاءت إليه امرأة وعرضت على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ولها غلام النجار فعرضت عليه أن تصنع له منبر يقوم عليه حتى يخلي منه فوافق النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأرسل إليها وأمرها بصناعة المنبر وجيء به وهو له ثلاث درجات من شجرة الإثم فلما كان يوم الجمعة قام النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على ذلك المنبر ليخطب في الناس وبينما هو يخطب وإذا بذلك الجذع الذي كان يقوم إليه يحن ويبكي يا سبحان الله يبكي ذلك الجذع حتى يكاد ينشق فنزل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حتى أخذه فضمه إليه قال جابر فجعلت تئن أنير الصبي نخلة جذع نخلة وكان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يضمه كالذي يفتته حتى هدأ فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إنها بكت أي هذه النخلة إنها بكت على ما كانت تسمع من الذكر لما فارقها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بكت انظروا معاشر السامعين خشبة جامدة تبكي على فراق النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم قال عليه الصلاة والسلام والله هو الذي نفسي بيده لو لم أحتضنه لحن إلى يوم القيامة وفي رواية أنس فأمر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بها فدفنت فهذه جماد تحب محمد بن عبد الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فما بال هذا الإنسان الذي ربما قصر في محبة النبي واتباعه ونقل عنه والتحاكم إلى شرعه وتطبيق أحكامه وما جاء به عليه الصلاة والسلام تفضل
The noble Shaykh, may Allah preserve him, he said it comes from reports found in Bukhari and Jabir bin Abdullah, and also he said Sahal bin Sa'ad, and also he mentioned that other reports come on other Sahabas that a woman. A woman from Ansar said to Allah's Messenger, shall I make something for you to sit on, as I have a slave who's a carpenter? He replied by saying, if you wish. So she got a pulpit made for him. When it was a Friday, the Prophet ﷺ sat on that minbar, the date palm stem near with which the Prophet ﷺ used to deliver his sermons. So later on, this minbar, where this is made from date palm stem, cried so much that it was about to burst. The Prophet ﷺ came down from the pulpit to the stem and embraced it, and it started to make a noise like a child when it's in that state of crying. So the Prophet persuaded it to stop crying, and then it stopped crying. The Prophet said it has cried because of missing what it used to hear of religious knowledge on the minbar. So here the Shaykh, he says, look, a date palm stem is crying out of respect and missing the guidance, religion guidance of that Prophet used to deliver on it. That it used to cry because of what it missed from the remembrance of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. So it was crying upon the firaq of not having the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on it to deliver such ceremonies. And it comes that if it wasn't for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam persuading it to stop crying, it would have cried to Yawm al-Qiyamah. And it also comes in the narration of Anas that they buried this pulpit or this piece of stem of the date palm. There then the Shaykh goes on to say, this is regarding jamadat, objects, a date palm or things that are not humans and animals. So what about greater preference with the human being? That he should be more in a state of love and veneration for the legislation that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with and to be submitted for it. Follow the Shaykh.
هكذا روى الإمام أحمد من حديث أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه، والحديث في الصحيح المسند من دلائل النبوة لشيخنا الإمام الواجعي رحمة الله عليه، قال: كان أهل بيت من الأنصار لهم جمل يثنون عليه، بمعنى أنهم يخرجون عليه الماء من البئر لسقي الزرع في النخيل، يجعلون القربة أو القرب أو الوعاء في البئر ويسحبونه على هذا البعير. قال: وإن الجمل استصعب عليهم فمنعهم ظهره، بمعنى أنه توحش. هذا الجمل صار متوحشا، لا يرضى أن يعمل ولا أن يقترب منه أحد، فصاروا يخافون منه. وجاء الأنصار إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقالوا: إنه كان لنا جمل نثني عليه، وإنه استصعب علينا ومنعنا ظهره، وقد عطش الزرع والنخل يا رسول الله. جاءوا يشتكون، كيف يسمعون لهذا الجمل؟ فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لأصحابه: قوموا. فقاموا فدخلوا الحائط والجبل في ناحية، فمشى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم نحوه، فقال الأنصار: يا نبي الله، إنه قد صار مثل الكلب الكلب، وإنا نخاف عليك صلته. الرسول يتقدم إلى الجمل، الجمل متوحش، أصحاب الجمل يخافون على النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم، فيطمئنهم رسولنا صلى الله عليه وسلم ويقول لهم: ليس علي منه بأس، ليس علي منه بأس. فلما نظر الجمل إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أقبل نحوه حتى خر ساجدا بين يديه. سبحان الله، جمل متوحش، ربما كان يأكل من اقترب منه. فلما جاء النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ذل وخضع بين يديه وسجد، فأخذ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بناصيته أذل ما كانت قط حتى أدخله في العمل. رجع هذا الجمل هادئا مطمئنا. فقال له أصحابه: يا رسول الله، هذه بهيمة لا تعقل تسجد لك ونحن نعقل، فنحن أحق أن نسجد لك. فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم: لا يصلح لبشر أن يسجد لبشر، ولو صلح لبشر أن يسجد لبشر لأمرت المرأة أن تسجد لزوجها. من عظم حقه عليها والذي نفسي بيده لو كان من قدمه إلى مفرق رأسه قرحة تلبس بالقيح والحبيب ثم استقبلته فلحسته ما أدت حقه. الشاهد من هذا الحديث حيوان لكنه يحب النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى اله وسلم. لم يكن مكلفا، لم يبعث اليه، لم يرسل اليه رسول، ولم يبعث اليه قران، ينزل اليه القران. ومع ذلك يعظم نبينا صلى الله عليه وسلم ويحبه ويخضع له. ونحن اكرمنا الله عز وجل بالعقول والاسماع والابصار والنعم الكثيره وأنزل إلينا القرآن وبعث إلينا النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام، ومع ذلك من الناس من يعرض عن سنته ويبتعد عن هديه عليه الصلاة والسلام. تفضل. تفضل.
The noble Shaykh, may Allah preserve him. He said, likewise, it was reported in Musnad Imam Ahmed from the hadith of Anas bin Malik. And he said this hadith is found in a Sahih Musnad, Fi Dalail al-Nubuwa, in the book, the authentic compilation of what indicates the prophecy of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the hadith concerning that topic. He mentions the hadith that there were a household from the Ansar. They had a camel which they would load waters upon its humps. At a time, there was a time where this camel refused. It refused that for them to do so, to put loads of waters on its humps. So they complained to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whereas this camel was in a state tawahash, it became like a wild animal. No one was able to come near it. So they went to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they said, "We have a camel that we put loads of water on its humps, and it refused and it became like a wild animal. And our plants and our area for vegetation has become dry, O Messenger of Allah." So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to his companions, "Qumu, faqamu, stand." So they stood. So they entered the hayat, a garden which was surrounded with a wall, and the jamal was in a corner. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam walked towards his direction. So they said to the Messenger of Allah, "Verily, it is a camel that has become similar to like a wild dog, and we fear upon you that it becomes, that it may attack you, O Messenger of Allah." So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Laysa alayya minhu ba'sun." There's no harm upon me from it. So he looked to the camel. The camel looked towards the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it went towards him, and it went into prostration right in front of him. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So here he says, look, it went into prostration. From being a wild animal, it goes into submission right in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam grabbed it by its forelock, and it became subservient or submissive to it, up until he made it work upon what they wanted it to do of carrying loads of water. So they said, "O Messenger of Allah, this is a behemoth. This is an animal that has no intellect, and it prostrates for us. And we are humans that have intellect, so it's more deserving that we prostrate for you." So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "It's not befitting for a human to prostrate for a human." And if he said if it was suitable and appropriate for a human to prostrate for another, لَأَمَرْتُ الْمَرْأَ أَن تَسْجُدَ لِزَوْجِهَا, I would command a woman to prostrate for her husband. من عظم حقه عليها, from the greatness of his right over her. And then he mentions, والذي نفسي بيدي, لو كان من قدمه إلى مفرق رأسه قرحة, that if it was from his toes to his head, a wound which was coming out from it pussed, and she were to wipe it off by using her mouth to remove it, she wouldn't have fulfilled his rights. He would have fulfilled his rights. So he says, what the point of this hadith, me mentioning it, this is concerning an animal that hasn't heard the Quran. It doesn't know of the legislation. It doesn't know about the detail of what we know regarding the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and is doing this in front of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of submission. So we are those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has honored us with hearing and seeing, and we know of the dispatchment of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are more deserving to be of those who follow the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And unfortunately, it's the case where we find some people who avert and turn away from his guidance. Tafadhal ya Shaykh.
وهما جاء عند الإمام أحمد عن عبد الله بن جعفر وأصله في صحيح الإمام مسلم. قال عبد الله بن جعفر: أردفني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات يوم خلقه فأسر إلي حديثا لا أخبر به أحدا أبدا, وكان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أحب ما استتر به في حاجته هدف أو حائش نخل, وهذا في صحيح مسلم. وزاد بعد ذلك قال: فدخل يوما حائطا من حيطان الأنصار فإذا جبل قد أتاه, الجبل يأتي إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, فلما رأى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حن وذرفت عيناه, الجبل يبكي. لما رأى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يبكي وتنزل الدموع من عينيه وهو حيوان, سبحان الله. قال: فمسح النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فراسه وذكراه ففتن, فقال: من صاحب الجمل؟ هدأ الجمل بعد أن مسح النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في رأسه, هدأ الجمل. فقال: من صاحب الجمل؟ فجاء فتن من الأنصار فقال: هو لي يا رسول الله, هذا جمل. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: أما تتق الله في هذه البهيمة التي ملكتها الله؟ إنه شكى إلي أنك تجيعه وتذئبه, أي تتعبه. الجمل يبكي عند النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ويشتكي لأن صاحبه يتركه بدون طعام, وربما يعمل عليه كثيرا حتى يتعب. فشكى إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وبكى بين يديه عليه الصلاة والسلام. ولهذا فإن النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم جعل الله عز وجل في قلبه الرحمة العظيمة والخير الكثير, وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين. ويقول الله عز وجل: قد جاءكم رسول من أنفسكم عزيز عليه ما عنتم حريص عليكم بالمؤمنين رؤوف رحيم. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم جعل الله فيه خيرا كثيرا, حتى استجابت له الحيوانات, واستجابت له الجمادات, واستجاب له العرب, واستجاب له العجم. ولهذا فإن من المؤسف أو المحزن أن تجد في هذه الأزمان المتأخرة ممن يدعي أنه من أتباع محمد عليه الصلاة والسلام, وهو حتى ربما لا يعرف سيرته, بل ربما لا يحفظ اسمه الكامل, ولا يتابعه في الأوامر, ولا ينتهي عما نهى عنه من النواهي والزواجر, وهذا من التقصير العظيم. تفضل بارك الله.
The noble Shaykh, may Allah preserve him, he said another incident concerning an animal relating to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a hadith, a narration that comes on Abdullah ibn Ja'far, reported by Ahmed, and his origin is found in Sahih Muslim. That The Prophet ﷺ was went to fulfill the call of nature, and as is known from the Prophet ﷺ that he would seek the likes of a wall of a garden to conceal himself and to be far away from the people. Here there then a camel. So there then a camel. He witnessed a camel that was crying. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tapped it on his head and wiped over it with his hand up until the camel became tranquil and calm. So he said, "Man sahib hadha al-jamal?" Who is the companion? Who is the owner of this camel? So a man from the Ansar, he said, "I, O Messenger of Allah." So the Prophet ﷺ said, "Do you not fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concerning the likes of these animals? Really complain to me that you keep it in a state of hunger, starve it, and you leave it without water to drink." And he said, perhaps he even, the Shaykh comments, they said, perhaps he even exhausts it, overworks it with heavy loads. So it complained to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, the Shaykh says, subhanallah, look at this. A camel crying to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put in the heart of his Messenger of mercy and passion and goodness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We haven't dispatched you, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, except as a means of mercy for mankind. And he mentioned the ayah, قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رُسُولٌ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِتُّمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. Has come to you a messenger from yourselves, that it harms him what harms you. And it harms him what harms you. حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ, that he's zealous for your own good, and he strives for your own good. And he is one that is merciful and passionate upon you. So he says, this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts of goodness in his Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. To the extent that even animals, yani istijabala, the animals answered his call. All sorts of people answered his call. So the Shaykh went on to mention that it's sad and unfortunate that we find those who claim to follow Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to love him, yet perhaps they don't even know his seerah. They don't have no knowledge concerning his seerah. Or maybe they don't even memorize the full name of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he says, you find with that they fall short in following his guidance, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Tafadhal ya Shaykh.
بارك الله فيكم. فنبينا صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم كانت تحبه المخلوقات جميعا وتعظمه كما أراد الله عز وجل, بل حتى الجمادات والجبال والأشجار. فهذا جبل أحد, وجبل أحد وما أدراك ما جبل أحد, جبل ضخم وسلسلة جبلية من وصل إلى المدينة يعرف ما هو جبل أحد. رجع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من بعض الغزوات, فلما راى جبل احد قال لاصحابه, هذا احد جبل يحبنا ونحبه. والحديث في الصحيحين, جبل يحبنا ونحبه, جبل يحب النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى اله وسلم. ولما صعد عليه الصلاه والسلام يوما من الايام ومعه ابو بكر وعمر, وإذا بالجبل يرتجف يرتد. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: اثبت احد، فما عليك الا نبي او صديق او شهيد. فثبت الجبل ولم يتحرك، يطيع ويسمع اوامر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، واذا راه يحبه، يحبه، يحب النبي عليه الصلاه والسلام. جمادات تعظم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وتحبه. وهكذا جاء في صحيح مسلم عن جابر بن سمره قال: النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: اني لاعرف حجرا بمكه كان يسلم علي. الرسول عليه الصلاه والسلام يمر بجانب هذه الحجر فيسلم على النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى اله وسلم. وهذا من دلائل النبوه العظيمه. فالجمادات والحيوانات تعظم نبينا صلى الله عليه وعلى اله وصحبه وسلم، وهو تعظيم شرعي بما أراد الله تبارك وتعالى، ليس تعظيما بأن يرفع فوق منزلته فتجعل له منزلة الربوبية والألوهية، ولكن مقام النبوة والرسالة التي وضعها له ربه سبحانه وتعالى. نعم، تفضل.
The noble Shaykh, may Allah preserve him, he went on to say, may Allah bless you, barakallahu feekum, our noble messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of different creatures, used to love him to the extent of even jamadat, objects, things of that sort. He said, even the trees, the mountains. He said, it comes regarding the mountain of Uhud. And he says, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ what will make you come to know regarding the mountain of Uhud? That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once returned from one of his expeditions, and he said regarding, he seen the mountain of Uhud when they passed by it. He says, this is a mountain that we love and it loves us. And also it comes that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once climbed the mountain of Uhud and it began to shake. So the Prophet ﷺ said, "Uthbut Uhud," become calm or and he steady, not shaking. So and he said, "It is not upon you except two martyrs, ma'alika illa nabiyun wa siddiqun wa shahidan. It's only upon you. It's only on you is two martyrs and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, which are the two martyrs, meaning Uthman and Umar." So there then it began to become calm, motionless, accepting the command of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the case that when it would see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it would even increase in love. يعني إذا رآه يحبه. He says these are the jamadat, objects. And he says also it comes in Sahih Muslim on Jabir and Samura, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, verily I know a rock or a stone in Mecca, that used to send salutation upon me before his dispatchment. He says, he passes by the side of a stone, this stone, and it begins to send salutation upon me. This is from the La ilaha Nabuwah that indicates his prophethood. So these animals, these objects, these things would immense him and venerate him, but in a way, in a manner that is shar'iyya, legislated. They wouldn't raise him above his manzila, his status, like to the extent of raising him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the level of rububiyya, to the lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or to the uluhiyya of Allah, the worship of Allah. For verily, they would only give him the maqam al-risala wal-nabuwa, to the status of being a prophet and a messenger. Follow the Sheikh.
بارك الله فيكم. وفي الختام، ختام هذه الكلمة والكلام كثير، ولكن في ختام هذه الكلمة ينبغي أن نعلم أن الواجب علينا عباد الله تجاه هذا النبي الكريم أن نطيعه فيما أمر وأن نمتنع عما نهى عنه وزجر وأن نصدقه فيما أخبر. وهذا مقتضى ما جعل الله عز وجل به مكانته وقرنها بشهادته، فنحن نقول أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. فالإقرار له بالرسالة والنبوة يستلزم أن نتعرف على سيرته وحياته وأخلاقه وعقيدته وعبادته ومعاملته فنسير فيها ونعمل بها. لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة، قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحبكم الله ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم وإن تطيعوه تهتدوا وما على الرسول إلا البلاغ المبين. نتعرف على سيرته ونقرأ أحاديثه ونعمل بذلك وندافع عن دينه وندافع عن دينه وعما جاء به عليه الصلاة والسلام. فنسأل الله عز وجل أن يوفقنا وإياكم والسامعين ومن سمع هذا الكلام إلى وأن يوفقنا لطاعته ومرضاته وأن يرزقنا العلم النافع والعمل الصالح وأن يجعلنا هداة مهتدين غير ضالين ولا مضلين وأن يجعلنا من أتباع هذا النبي الكريم الذين يعظمونه حق تعظيمه ويشدونه محبة شرعية ويعملون بما جاء في سنته ويبتعدون عن كل ما دعا إلى مخالفته يبتعدون عن كل شيء أمر بمخالفته وأمر ونهى عنه عليه الصلاة والسلام. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وبارك الله فيكم.
أحسن الله إليك يا شيخ، الله يكرم. وفي الختام the noble sheikh said, closing these words, and he says, the words concerning this topic can go on and on. But he says, in conclusion, what is obligatory and mandatory concerning the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that we obey him in what he commands, and that we refrain from what he has prohibited, and that we believe and attest to what he has informed. He says, this is muqtada. This is what has been necessitated through attesting that he's a messenger and his position, his status. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qaranahu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned him along in the shahada that we attest to. So when we are saying that ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, it necessitates that we learn about his seerah, and that we learn about his aqidah, and we try to implement what he used to be upon. And he mentioned the ayah, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. Verily in the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a good example. لِمَنْ كَانَ يُرْجُوا اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. For the one that hopes in Allah and also in the last day. And also he mentioned the ayah, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرُ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. That say, O Muhammad, that if you truly love Allah, then follow me. And really Allah will love you, and He will forgive for you your sins. And also the ayah, وَإِن تُطِيعُوهُ تَهْتَدُوا. That if you obey Him, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you will become rightly guided. So he says, it's upon us to become familiar with his seerah. Familiar with his seerah, his biography. And familiar with what he came with, what he was dispatched with. And to be defenders of his religion, and to be those who act upon it. The Shaykh went on to end with making dua by saying, we ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to make us of those who are granted and given the sustenance of beneficial knowledge and righteous good deeds, and also to be from the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, those who follow him correctly as it should, and those who implement his sunnah and fulfill his commands and avoid what he has prohibited. And he says, وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا أَنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. And the last of our words is, all praise due to Allah. SubhanAllah.